I'm going to say that one more time. I said he is the living word.
Yes, he is.
Because if he wasn't, we wouldn't be here today. Amen.
Right. Amen.
I don't know what you come to do, but I came to lift up the name of Jesus. I don't know what you came to do, but I came to clap my hands. I don't know what you came to do, but I come to stomp my feet. I don't know what you came to do, but I came to shout for joy. Amen. Because Jesus is the living word.
Amen.
Somebody said that it's preaching time. Amen. Somebody said it's preaching time. Now, as for me, I have absolutely nothing to say.
Amen.
But we know that the Holy Ghost is able. Amen. So if you all pray, I say if you all pray, I know that the Holy Ghost will show up. Amen. I say if you all pray, that the Holy Ghost will not might.
Will.
Not maybe, Pastor. But the Holy Ghost, my sister, First Lady,
gonna show up.
If we pray, the Holy Ghost will show up. Amen.
Amen.
It is indeed a privilege and an honor to stand before God and God's people on this glorious day. Amen.
Amen.
It is indeed a privilege because we did not have to be here. Amen.
Amen.
Because somebody didn't wake up this morning, amen?
All right, all right.
Somebody laid down last night and they pressed their head against a dying pillow, amen?
Amen.
But God saw fit, not because you were so good, not because you did anything that was so good, not because you thought anything that was so good, but because he's so good, that he woke us up this morning and started us on our way. I would like to thank my pastor for the opportunity to come before you on this, our Women's Day. I would like to thank my father in the ministry, Presiding Elder Holmes. I would like to thank you all for being in your places. I would like to thank especially some people, my mother-in-law, amen, my fiance's mom,
amen,
Mama Judy, Paul, my oldest daughter, Cecilia, my daughter, Roberta, from another mother, and you, my brothers and sisters, in Christ Jesus. Oh, wait a minute, wait a minute. Hold the phone. We got the Leia in the house. Amen. Amen. We got the Leia in the house. Amen. On the front pew. Amen. Now she on the front pew today, amen.
Okay.
We going on the front pew next Sunday.
Amen.
Amen. And we have my beautiful grandchildren. Amen. From the youngest to not the eldest, but the eldest that's here today. So it's always joy to look out and see my brothers and sisters in Christ, but it's always a delight to look out and see my children.
Amen.
Amen. The scripture which was read for us today come from Ecclesiastes, the 3rd chapter, verses 1 through 8. And it reads as such. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to search and a time to give up. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to mend. A time to be silent and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. Now, most of you that have read this particular scripture from Ecclesiastes, this particular passage of scripture is often used as a homegoing message. Mm-hmm. But on this particular day, God has provided a word for us of encouragement on this Women's Day. Amen?
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, all of you and none of me, I ask that you remove me from self and allow the anointing to take full control, that we might hear your words through your messenger, through your way. Father, I believe if I have the faith, you have the power to rain down the power of the Holy Spirit upon your servant.
Yes.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be found acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Let all the brothers and the sisters say amen.
Amen.
Our focus verse for today is verse 1. It says there is a time for everything. And a season for every activity under the sun. Once again, there is a time for everything. And there's a season for every activity under the sun. Now, if you would allow me to use or entertain for a subject for just a little while. Because as I said, Becky has nothing to say. But we don't know what the Holy Ghost has. But if you would allow me to entertain for a subject, it's your season for grace and favor. Look at the person sitting next to you and tell them, it's your season for grace and favor. All right, y'all didn't say that like y'all meant it or believed it. I said, look to the person next to you and say, it's your season for grace and faith. Amen. That sounded a little better. Let me get my paper back in. Okay. Today's text comes from one of our books of poetry, also known as books of wisdom that we've learned through our Bible study. Ain't that right, Pastor?
Amen.
Now, Solomon, the son of David, has been given credit as being the author of this particular book, and the time has been narrowed down to 931 BC.
All right.
The book of Ecclesiastes teaches us that life which is not totally centered on God is purposely and meaningless, because without God, we can never be satisfied or know the fullness of satisfaction. But with him, all of life and his good gifts can be gratefully received and used and enjoyed to the fullest. In the first and second chapter, the author tells of the vanities of human wisdom and the vanities of pleasure and wealth, further stating how none of this is new. Now, Solomon, the Bible lets us know that he wrote more about vanity than any other author, for it is mentioned 32 to 35 times in Ecclesiastes alone. Solomon emphasizes on the futility of vanity of riches. Is when a man to whom God has given wealth and possessions and honor, so that he lacks nothing that he desires, yet God does not give him the power to enjoy them. But a stranger enjoys them. Solomon spoke of how one labors and it's meaningless, because those who labor for selfish reasons, not being God-centered, won't live to enjoy anything. And that all that they have worked for will go to someone else that hasn't did anything. Solomon further expounds on the fact that none of this is new, that history just continues to repeat itself over and over. Solomon even questions why he even had wisdom. He stated that one dies and leaves everything to strangers, who you don't even know if they'll have the wisdom or be foolish enough to take care of that which is left behind, but states that it doesn't matter being foolish or wise, that both of us one day shall die. But it is in chapter 3 that he informs us that none of it really matters, because when it's all said and done, there's a time for everything. And that time is not determined by you or I, but rather it is appointed by God.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
But God wanted me to inform you that it's your season for grace and for favor. Now, I want to talk to you for a little while about seasons. Now, how many of you realize that our seasons actually start at conception? Our seasons start at conception because when you look at the time of conception, it takes up to 9 months for us to form within our mother's womb. Then once we're born, we go into what we're called our informative years. You know, we learn how to start moving. We learn to see things. We learn how to start crawling and then eventually walking. We also learn how our physical body starts taking change. Just like my grandbaby Bella, she's one now, but I could go back and remember when she was 2 weeks and 3 months, and now she's at that physical state. And not only that, now she's in the mental state because she starts to recognize people and she knows who she can trust and who she can and who she feels secure with. So that's another season. Then we move on to our intellectual season, where we start gaining wisdom and knowledge of things. Now, there also is a moral season and a spiritual season. Now, that's not anything that we can teach one another. That's something that you learn to accept along the way, right from wrong, your spirituality. When we were shaped and we were taught, we call that time our springtime. That's the period from the year 1 to 20. Y'all remember your springtime when you was young? You thought that you could run around and do everything. You had so much energy.
Yes.
You could fall and get back up the same day. You could break something and it'd be healed within the next couple of weeks. Your springtime, that's the time when you start dreaming and having aspirations of what you want to become in life. You know, when we young, we said we want to be doctors, lawyers. I don't know about y'all, but when we was little, we wanted to be cowboys and Indians and things of that nature. But now, you know, kids say, I want to be a doctor, I want to be a lawyer, I want to be a psychiatrist. This is the time when we start thinking and putting things in somewhat of perspective as to which way we want our life to go. Some of us end up going through school and graduating, then going on to college, springtime. Then we go from our 20 to 40 season. Now, this is the season where most of us have gotten our careers. Some of us have changed careers a couple of times because that wasn't a fit, and we're trying to find that perfect fit. Some of us have married. Some of us have even divorced by this time because we discovered that the one that we married when we was 18 and 20, she's not, or he's not the one that works out for me at from 20 to 40.
Well.
So now we've divorced. Some of us have had children. Some of us haven't had children. Now, this period and this season is considered to be our summer. Then we get to our 40 to our 60 season.
All right.
Say ouch. 60, our 60 season. Well, this season here is a season, Roberta, when we quit lying to ourselves. Mama Judy, we start telling ourself the truth, because when we was 20 and 40, if the truth be told, we dated people, Sister Anna, that we said was fine. We thought they was fine. They looked fine to us. But when we got 40 and 60, we start seeing that brother, that sister that we was dating when we was 20. And we looking at them like, did I date him? Did I date her? You know, you thought you had it going on, but you had the blinders on. But when you get in that 40 to 60 season, you deal with the reality of things, the way that they really are. You don't lie to yourself anymore. You meet somebody passing, you let them know right off the rip, this ain't going to work.
Right off the rip.
You know, this is not going to work. Because all it takes is a couple of conversations, and you can tell, because between 40 to 60, you know where you're at.
Yes.
You know where you want to be.
Yes.
You know where you're trying to go.
Uh-huh.
And you know you're not trying to go
back.
And raise nobody's son or raise nobody's daughter. Yes. Amen. Yes. To be what you want them to be.
Say it again.
This season is called our fall. And in the fall, things start falling away. Some of our hair start falling away. Our teeth start falling away. Some of our friends start falling away.
That's right.
Some of our memories start falling away.
Yes.
The fall time.
Fall time.
Then we get to the season, 60 to 80. This is the season that we start reflecting on all that we've done, all that we've accomplished. We start looking back and playing the tapes back in our mind, wondering if everything that we did, everything that we worked so hard for, all the information that we tried to give our children, all the rights and wrongs that we tried to teach them, if anything that we did was pleasing to God.
Mm-hmm.
Not to us.
To God.
But to God.
My.
We start reflecting and just sitting back, just looking back over our life and just wanting to know, does the good outweigh the bad?
Mm-hmm.
Because we know on that road from 1 to 80, everything wasn't good.
Right.
And like Papa Holmes say, it wasn't always a zippity-doo-dah, zippity-good day. Amen. There were some hard times in between that 1 to 80.
Yes.
But this is the time that's called our winter. And in our winter comes the time where we start looking at life and saying, you know, God, I thank you for keeping me as long as you have.
Yes.
Because you didn't have to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when we get to that season, we know that if we see that 3 score and 10, that 70, we bless.
Yeah.
But if we see 80,
mm-hmm,
or 81,
yes,
we know that that's favor.
Yes.
Seasons.
Well.
But one thing is very clear. Life is full of surprises. So we seem to think. But it's all according to your season and God's timing. We can't obtain anything if it's not our time. But God wants you to know that he has seen your seasons of depression. He wants you to know that he's seen your season of addiction. You know that you're in this addiction that you think that you got a handle on, and you've been fighting this thing. You've been trying to get rid of it, and you just can't seem to shake this thing. You done went to AA. You done went to another program. You can't get rid of it. He said he's seen your season of betrayal. He said he's seen your season of your financial distress. He said he's also seen your season of hopelessness. He said, I've seen your season when you felt like nobody cares. He said, I've looked at your seasons of you saying, God, you're not answering my prayers.
All right.
But he wanted me to stop by to encourage you and let you know that although I've seen all these things and you've gone through all these things,
right,
this is your time, this is your season, it's your season for grace and favor.
Amen. Amen.
For you see, it's not that God has forsaken or forgot about us.
Mm.
It was just not your season.
Your season.
Remember, there is a time for everything and for every season. If you don't believe me, Galatians 6:9 says it this way, and let us not grow weary,
right,
of doing good,
uh-huh,
for in due season, we will reap if what?
Maybe
if we don't give up. That means that, you know, there's going to be good times,
mm-hmm,
in life. There's going to be some bad times. And it's the same with our spiritual walk. There's going to be some good times,
good time,
and then there's going to be some challenges.
Yes, it is.
But we have to hold on and don't give up. But see, we don't wait for our season.
Uh-huh.
Before our season gets there, we jump ship.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we be right at the brink,
right,
of,
right,
our breakthrough. And we jump ship.
Yes.
You know, we listening to somebody say, well, you need to come over here. You need to go over there.
Uh-huh.
You need to do this. You can have church at home.
All right,
and
Reverend,
you right at the brink,
mm-hmm,
of your season.
Well,
yes.
This is your season for grace and faith. Yes, there's a season for death. Yes, there's a season to laugh. Yes, there's a season to weep. Yes, there is a season of war, but there is also a season of grace and favor.
Yes,
my sisters, God made women. I believe God made us so so unique.
Yes.
Because we have so many hats that we wear.
Right.
We're daughters. We're sisters.
Uh-huh.
We're wives. We're friends. We're teachers. Mm-hmm. We're seamstresses. We're healers. We're counselors. Yes. We're lawyers. We're grandmothers.
Right. Call the roll now.
We're cooks.
Right.
We're secretaries. We're maids,
yes.
We're sounding boards,
yes.
We're disciplinarians,
yes.
We're lovers,
yes.
We're confidants,
yes.
We're intercessors,
yes.
And we're mothers.
Right.
And the list could go on,
yes.
And on,
yes.
And on.
Amen.
But God is saying, because you are all these things,
uh-huh.
And because you have endured all these things,
uh-huh.
God is saying, it's your season for grace and faith. Now, I don't know about you, but I thank God for my seasons.
Mm-hmm.
I thank God for my seasons of life. For without the mistakes.
Uh-huh. Right.
For without the tears.
Uh-huh.
For without the deaths. For without the sorrow.
Mm-hmm.
For without the disappointments. Without the heartaches. Without the sickness. I wouldn't be standing here before
say
you
that,
today.
Say that, say that.
For you see, it took a season,
uh-huh.
Pastor, me bumping my head into a wall.
Uh-huh.
It took a season, Robin,
uh-huh.
of me running my head into a wall.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Not understanding that God had something better for me. I didn't have to bump my head so many times, but it's just like we tell our children.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
You know, I've told my children, it's a whole lot of stuff you ain't got to go through.
Yes.
Why? Because I already paid the price for that. You know, you don't have to go and see what alcohol tastes like because I did that for you. You don't have to go see what drugs taste like because I did that for you. You don't have to go and have no run-in with the police because I did that for you. You don't have to go out and be fighting because I did that for you. You don't have to go into the clubs
because
I did that for you.
Yes, tell your testimony now.
Just like God had to work in me,
uh-huh.
He had to work in him.
Yes.
It was my season
mm-hmm.
for grace and faith.
Yes.
But I try to teach them that it might not be that season
well,
to you, so you don't want to go do that thing.
Go do that.
I try to teach my grandkids, you don't want to do that.
Mm.
Why? Because your grandmama did it, your mama's doing it, so you don't want to do it.
Okay?
It's already been paid now. It's your season.
You go home now.
The grace and faith.
Good word.
For it took me a lifetime, Reverend Holmes,
snitching on
of trying to do it my way. Only to discover
mm-hmm.
that God's way was so much
easier. It was.
You know, I was working myself
mm-hmm.
against myself.
Mm-hmm.
Until I knew, Viola, that God's way was so much easier.
Right.
I ain't looked back since.
Yeah.
I ain't looked back since, Pastor. Because it's no more sleepless nights.
Mm-hmm.
Ain't got to be looking over your shoulder.
Mm.
Wondering who coming,
mm.
who ain't coming.
Right.
What drink you got to drink. What dope you got to buy? What bar you got to go to?
Mm-hmm.
Peace. Amen.
Peace.
It said that I give you peace.
Yes.
Which surpasses all understanding.
I hear you, preacher. I hear you.
It took a lifetime for me to understand that. It took some depths for me to understand that although I loved my loved ones,
mm-hmm.
that God loved them better.
Well.
And he loved them first.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes we go through life and we think that we in control of something.
Mm-hmm.
And God had to let us know that you ain't controlling nothing. Because
no.
if I let you control just your very thought,
well,
you will mess that up.
Brother
Amen.
Straight.
There are lessons to be learned in your season.
Yeah.
How many of you realize it's lessons to be learned?
Uh-huh.
But you know what? Some of us go through life and never learn the lesson, Reverend Holmes. Some of us go through to the very end.
Mm-hmm.
And can't nobody never tell you nothing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think that people think that when you're trying to tell them something for their own good, that you're trying to keep them from having a good time.
Well,
I'm not trying to keep you from having a good time. I want you to have a good time, but I want you to have a wholesome good time. Because, see, there are ways that we can enjoy ourselves that don't put us at risk, amen?
Amen?
Anything that puts you at risk, whether it's physically, financially,
mm-hmm.
then you need to say no to that,
mm-hmm.
amen?
Amen?
It's your season for grace and favor. Get the most out of your season. Mm-hmm. You know, one thing I learned about my seasons as I matured was that instead of saying, why me, because we can have that pity party all the time. Why me? Why I can't be so-and-so? Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. I come to church every Sunday, I tithe, why I got to be me? Why I can't get the new car? Why I can't get the new house? You know, instead of saying, why me, I learned to ask the question, God, what do I take from this season? Mm-hmm. What's the message in this lesson? And we need to start asking God, what do I take from this? You know, death is not the end, it's the beginning. And we need to start asking God when we go and experience death, what is the lesson in this message for me, amen? Because sometimes death is the only thing that brings people together. Outside of that, they don't ever see each other. Until what? The next death.
Yes.
Church, it's your season for grace and favor. Psalms 104 and 19 says it this way. He appointed the moon for seasons. The sun knows it's going down. It's your season for grace and favor. Church, God has heard your cries. He has felt your tears and declares it's your season. It's your season of hope in the Lord. It's your season of joy, unspeakable joy. It's your season of peace which surpasses all understanding. It's your season of prosperity. It's your season of elevation. It's your season of happiness.
Yes.
It's your season of good health. It's your season to rebuild. Romans 8:28, one that Sister Johnson always says. And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. It's your season for grace and favor. Now you might be asking, preacher, how can I obtain this favor? Mm-hmm. Well, it's very simple. The first thing is by seeking to do good. Mm-hmm. Seeking to do good, not just to yourself. It's easy to do good to yourself and somebody you like. But to do good to that person that means you no good. To do good to that stranger. To do good to that child that you see, you notice every time you see them, they sitting off from the crowd.
Yes.
To do good. But Psalm 37 said, depart from evil and do good, so you will abide, not just sometimes, but it says forever. The second thing that we need to do to obtain this favor is to just try to live right. You know, a right way of living. What's right is not always what's best. And what's best is not always the comfortable thing to do. But if you do right, it's going to be right all the time. Amen? So we need to just try to practice doing the right thing. You know, this thing is not a difficult thing. You know, I've asked God over and over and over. I said, you know what? People try to make this walk a difficult thing. Mm-hmm. But he let me know. He said, Becky, speak to the people in the language by which they understand so that even the smallest of people can understand the message. So if we just try to do that, speak and give God's word in a way that everybody can understand it and do right, we on the right track. Amen?
Amen.
The third thing is to keep God's commands. Uh-huh. For in John it said, if you love him,
yes,
you'll do what?
You'll
keep his commandments. Yes. But we good at saying that we love the Lord.
Right.
We good at saying it. It's just like a cliche.
Right.
You know, just like that Nike, one of them said, just do it.
Mm-hmm.
We say that just like that. Just do. Oh, I love the Lord. Mm-hmm. But then we say we hate our sister. We hate our brother who we see every day.
Mm-hmm.
And we ain't even ever seen God.
Amen.
But we say we love God.
Mm-hmm.
How can you love him but you hate your sister, you hate your mama, you hate your cousin, you hate your preacher, you hate the pastor, you hate the choir members, you hate the usher, you hate the trustee, but then you sitting up here in church talking about hallelujah, praise the Lord, I love God.
Mm.
Come on, come on.
Come on, tell the truth, son.
You say, if you fall on your feet, say ouch, and just keep it moving, amen? Because of God's favor, Esther was able to save a nation. Then there is God's grace.
Yes.
There's God's grace. Thank God for grace. Grace is the gift from God given through his son, Jesus Christ. Unmerited favor.
Yes.
Unmerited favor. You can't do nothing to get it. Right. You can't pay for it. You know how people think they can buy everything? You can't buy it, can you, presiding elder home?
No way.
You can't buy it. Grace is the gift of God given through his son, Jesus Christ, unmerited favor. Through Christ, we are saved from sin and death. Church, it's your season for grace and favor. The things you've been believing God for, it's your season.
Yes.
The things you've been praying for, it's your season. Mm-hmm. The things you've been fasting for, it's your season. Mm-hmm. The things you've been dreaming on, it's your season. Mm-hmm. Things you have never believed would happen, God says it's possible. God is about to do a supernatural thing. So get ready, get ready, get ready. Because church is your season for grace and favor. Your life is about to change for the better. It's your season for grace and favor. Spring, summer, winter, and fall. It's your season. Church, salvation was the greatest gift of God's favor. And it was made available to us while we were still yet lost. Mm. Being born again was just the starting place for his favor to pour out. But God will pour out grace and more favor every moment of your life if you'll just receive it. But before you can receive the benefits of his favor, you must know that they are yours.
Yes.
You know, you have to claim that thing. You know, you have to say, this is mine. This is my grace. This is my favor. I don't know about you, but I love it when that thing is personal. Because when I know it's personal, I know it all belongs to me. You know, it don't belong to George. It belongs to Becky. Amen?
Amen.
So you have to know that it's yours.
Yes.
And you do that by receiving it by faith. It's your season for grace and favor. God has shown us that the devil offers us two kind of lies. He offers us the forever lie and the never lie. The enemy tells us that negative things in our lives will never change. You know how people say, you ain't gonna never amount to nothing. You ain't gonna never do no good. You ain't never been no good. You ain't never did nothing for nobody. That's the never lie that the devil tells you. The enemy tells us the negative things in our lives will never change and will forever be the way that they are. He tells us we will never get what we want and we will never experience the freedom of healing that we desire. He says that we will forever be in the same condition. You're going to forever be broke. You're going to be forever sick. You're going to be forever depressed. You're going to be forever alone. The forever and never lies. But Ecclesiastes reminds us that all we need to do is believe on God because he wants to change everything for the better. God wants your latter to be better than the first part of your life. He wants to bring you into a season of blessings. Despite what you've been through, despite how it looks, despite the medical report, whose report are you going to believe? I don't know about you, but I'm going to believe the report of the Lord. Despite what the naysayers say. You know the naysayers, the haters. If you ain't got no haters, then you ain't doing nothing.
Well,
that's what they say. If you ain't got no haters hating on you, then you ain't doing nothing for the Lord. Amen? And you know what? I think we all know that we got some haters, amen?
Amen.
Somebody that's sitting there smiling in your face at the same time talking about, oh, Christ our Redeemer, they ain't gonna do nothing. You know, they ain't got that many people over there. But God said it don't take a whole lot.
Amen.
It just take a lot that's willing and available.
Amen.
Amen. God wants you to know that it's your time. Ladies, it's your time for grace and favor. Children, it's your time for grace and favor. Men, it's your time for grace and favor. Pastor, it's your time for grace and favor.
Receive that.
Don't look at the pews. Don't look at the money. Mm. Keep looking at Jesus.
Yeah.
It's your time for grace and favor.
Yeah.
My brothers and my sisters, I stopped by here and I told you. I didn't have nothing to say, and hopefully the Holy Spirit had enough to say that you will leave here understanding that it doesn't matter what it looks like today. It doesn't matter what you went through last night. It doesn't even matter what you went through before you got here this morning. But God is saying that I can take whatever it was and I can turn that thing around because it is your season for grace and favor. Let us pray. Most gracious and eternal Father God, I come before you thanking you Thanking you, O God, for the presence of the Holy Spirit, which allows itself to have full reign throughout this church. Yes. Now, God, we just ask, O God, that we might be able to take these words and apply them to our lives. Lord, even if we came in here today with some heaviness, O God, let us not leave the same way that we came, because now we realize that it's our season for your grace and your favor. So, Father, we thank you, we praise you, we magnify your holy name. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.